Of change may rage tomorrow, God is at your side. No longer dread the fires of unexpected sorrow.
Trust in you and God. Our scripture reading this morning comes from the book of Acts, chapter 2. Acts, chapter 2. You can turn there with me if you have a Bible. We're going to be reading verses 42 through to verse 47. Pastor Mike will be preaching these verses in just a few minutes, and we'll remain standing together out of honor for the Lord and His Word. Acts, chapter 2, starting in verse 42. And they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. And awe came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were being done through the apostles. And all who believed were together and had all things in common. And they were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing the proceeds to all as any had need. And day by day, attending the temple together and breaking bread in their homes, they received their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to their number day by day those who were being saved. You may be seated. And in just a moment, we're going to go to the Lord in prayer. As we do, we will be praying this morning for one of our missionary families, and that's Tom and Marianne Barlow. They are serving in England, involved with church planting efforts there. So as we pray, we'll pray for them as well. Let's pray together. Lord, thank you for this passage that we just read. Thank you for these songs that we were just singing, and we thank you especially that by your wounds we've been healed, and we praise you as the one who's paid our debt and raised our life up from the dead. Lord, thank you that by faith we have been buried with you and risen again to newness of life, and now it's not us who live any longer, but it's you. It's you living out your life in us, and you together have called us to be your people, and we thank you so much for the privilege and joy that it is to be a part of your church. Lord, we thank you so much for the things that are mentioned in the book of Acts, the apostles' teaching, and we just are grateful this morning that as we hear this morning from your word about Jesus, about his death, about his burial, about his resurrection, we are right in line with what the church has believed from the very beginning, the apostles' teaching. And we're thankful for fellowship. Thank you for the blessing that it is to be able to go through life with people who know us and care about us through the best times and through the worst, and share together in the life in Christ that we have. Lord, we thank you for breaking of bread, not just for fellowship, but also to remember the death of Christ in our place and the shedding of his blood. And we thank you for prayer. Lord, thank you that you have called us into communion with yourself, and that individually from our own hearts we can be in prayer to you, and then together when we're here gathered, we can pray and worship you together and express our thanksgiving and our gratitude, and also intercede for the things that are on our hearts and that you're doing in the world. Lord, we just We thank you so much. Thank you that we are not lone wolves or lone rangers in this, but that you have made us a people, a holy people who belong to Christ. And we just pray that you would continue to transform us together into his image. Lord, we also do want to pray for the Barlows this morning. We thank you so much for Tom and Marianne and for their labor and work and the way that they're serving you in England. We know just from some of what they've shared that it's a dark place that they're in, and there's a lot of just kind of closed-off mindsets towards the gospel. And so we ask that you would just continue to move the gospel forward into new hearts, that you would bless them and their ministry and cause them to have patience, and that they would be strong and able to endure by your strength, that their service to you would be honoring to Christ. And Lord, we do pray that you would allow them to see the fruit of what they're doing, that there would be transformed lives, that people would come to Christ, and that you would bless even the efforts in the church plans so that believers would be brought towards maturity and be useful to you. Lord, we thank you for them, and we just pray that you would encourage them in their work, and that you would just help the believers all around the world who are connected with them to lift them up in prayer as well. Lord, we thank you for this morning to be together. We thank you that you are the one who builds your church, and we pray that you would receive all glory and honor and praise this morning. And it's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
Everything. this morning. Lord Jesus, thank you so much for your incredible grace and mercy toward even sinful people, Lord. God, we pray that you would remind us that it's through your grace, not even our own works or anything that we can do, but Lord, through your grace in Christ's sacrifice, that you've opened up a way for us to have a relationship with you, Lord, and to be in communion with you in heaven one day forever. So God, we praise you for that hope that you've given us in Christ. Lord, we pray that this morning you would help us to be humbly receptive to your word. Lord, would you please just open our eyes to the truth that you would have us receive? And God, we pray for your help and strength to live for you in the way that you would have us do. We love you, Lord. We ask that you be glorified this morning. It's in the name of Jesus that we pray. Amen.
It seems like everyone has an opinion of what the church is and should be and how it should operate. Common to hear it from those inside the church as well as outside the church. Evil people will say the church is trash. We would say that we are rubbish redeemed by blood. The community of the called out ones committed to Christ's kingdom. Today I want to take you back to the very heart of the first church and see the nature as well as the function of the church in Acts chapter 2, verses 41 to 47. Hopefully it will drive us to be more committed to Christ's kingdom and inform the way that we live and operate as a church. You think through the Bible and you think through the meandering Old Testament landscape, there ran a golden gospel promise thread. And at the same time, God's people were consistently and persistently unfaithful to the one who had promised to deliver them a new heart and save them from their many sins. And through the patriarchs and the prophets, the call to repent was ongoing. It was continual. Their sin, repressive. It was like quicksand. And the glory of God appeared when Christ was born, and for 33 years of his ministry, the light of the world, the bread of life, the great I am, the one who was promising fountains of living water for those who would believe and live evermore and promising to die for their sins. After his resurrection and appearance to so many, he ascended back to the Father before the very eyes of the apostles and the gathered faithful. And you have this newly birthed church that starts doing something because they are something. They're gathered expectantly after a soul-stirring sermon and signs and wonders at Pentecost, and around 3,000 new believers were baptized in obedience to Jesus, professing their faith and receiving the visible sign of repentance. And then they begin this common life. And it's this life, they're coming out of Judaism, they're coming from all over the known world, and this new family is showing forth a common life of those changed by God's grace for his glory. And we clearly see that the church is the community of the called out ones committed to Christ's kingdom. And so what I want to do today is look at the nature of the church, that it is from Christ, it is called by Christ, it is adopted by Christ, the community of the called out ones, but also the function of the church. So verse 41, we'll see the nature of the church, but then the function of the church in verses 42 to 47, that it exists for Christ. It is his. It belongs to him. They're committed to his kingdom. First, if you look at the idea of the nature of the church, like, what is it? It is from Christ, the community of the called out ones, that the Lord called out his very own. Verse 41, those who received his word were baptized, and there were added that day about 3,000 souls. So those who received the word of God, they welcomed the word of God, they wanted to be Christians, no one came kicking and screaming, And God changed their will, so they wanted to believe. That's what happens in a believer's life. God makes you willing. Jesus said, whoever is willing to do the will of God will know that the teaching is true. You believe the gospel and are saved. God changes your heart such that you receive what you once repudiated. You love now what you once hated. And these people were baptized. They willingly took the first step of obedient discipleship. They welcomed the word, and they did what Christians do. They professed their faith in Christ publicly and submit to being baptized. You'll notice that this passage doesn't contain the word church. It's dotted throughout the New Testament, but the Greek word translated church is ekklesia. The root meaning is to call out. The church is the called out assembly. And if you think about it, you can go back to Genesis chapter 1. God was calling out creation at that time, calling out the entire world into existence by his word. Over and over again, you see God said, and then this happened. Throughout the Old Testament, you see that God appeared to various people, either in his glory or through the prophets, and he was calling people to serve him over and over and over again. And you think about the idea of a calling. Everyone has callings in life, say a vocation, from the Latin word vocare, and the idea is a call. God gives you gifts and desires and opportunities to exercise God-given callings as a spouse, as a child, as a sibling, as a student, as a worker, as a citizen, and as a church member even. But when you think about the called out community, it only existed provisionally in the Old Testament. The Lord of the church had not yet died for his own. The Spirit of God had not yet been poured out to birth the church. And the church is God's vehicle for his redemptive plan to the nations. The church is the major New Testament doctrine, and God meets with his people in the church. God ministers through the preached word and through the ordinances and through the one another's of the gathered body. And Satan attacks the bride of Christ, the body of Christ, what God is building. Satan attacks anything good, just as in the garden. And the greatest worldly conflict, it's not in the socio-political realm. It is fought in and around and through the church. It is in the local church that we deal with heaven and hell. We deal with life and death. In case you have been disillusioned by the church, don't abandon the church because there's sinful people like you in that church. Many people will say, I don't want to become a Christian because Christians have hurt me, or the church has given me bad advice, or I don't believe it. And usually you want to work through those questions with them, but what you'll find is you come to a moral question. Are you willing to turn from your sins to Christ? God's plan to reach the nations. And what you'll notice is that in Acts chapter 2, Peter, he stands up. Here his, wimpy Peter before, and now he's bold Peter, and he stands up and he boldly and authoritatively preaches the word of God. And he's using places like Joel 2 and Psalm 110 and Psalm 16, and he's saying, this points to Jesus. And he said, let all the house of Israel therefore know, Acts 2:36, for certain, know this for certain, that God has made him both Lord and Christ, this Jesus whom you crucified. And it says, when they heard this, they were cut to the heart. They were convicted of their sins. And they said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, brothers, what shall we do? And Peter said to them, repent. Whenever you see repent in the Bible, believe is also assumed. If you see believe, repent is assumed. Repent, believe, and then be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ. Forgiveness of sins. You receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. And then he says in verse 39, for the promise is for you and your children and everyone who is far off, all, look at this, all who the Lord our God calls to himself. And they believed, verse 41, and they were baptized, the called out ones, the community of called out ones committed to Christ's kingdom. Thomas Watson once said this, when God calls a person by his grace, he cannot but come. You may resist the minister's call, but you cannot the Spirit's call. God does not force, but draw. The freedom of the will is not taken away, but the stubbornness of it is conquered. Others are more stubborn and naughty sinners, and God comes to them in a rough wind. He uses more wedges of the law to break their hearts. He deeply humbles them and shows them they are damned without Christ. And then, having plowed up the fallow ground of their hearts by humiliation, he sows the seed of consolation. Because the gospel, when you turn from your sins to Christ, the gospel comforts your heart, consoles your heart. Watson said, he presents Christ and mercy to them and draws their wills not only to accept Christ, but passionately to desire and faithfully to rest upon him. That you would rest your soul upon Christ. That day that the church was birthed. Verse 41 tells us, there were about 3,000 souls. We know they came from all over the known world, but we don't know how many from this location or that location. Just about 3,000 souls. Now, Christians are notorious counters. We like to count generously. But this just says, and I love it. My favorite word in that phrase is about. Like, it might have been 2,998. It might have been 3,156. Only God knows. But they just said it's about 3,000. No precise number. A little later on. Chapter 4, verse 4, many that heard the word believed, and the number of men was about 5,000. About. Church is growing, but after that, no more counting. Like in Revelation, you come to a multitude that no one can count. Should tell us something. We don't count very much at Grace, and I'm glad. It's like someone said, how many people go to Grace Church? I go, I don't know, whoever shows up. We gather committed to Christ and one another, and God adds. And he adds souls. Do you notice that? Souls. Not pinpointing where they came from, or what color their skin is, what kind of language they speak. Souls is an idiom for the whole person. They were added, literally won over. God drew them by his grace. You should never doubt the power of God to convert sinners. You should never doubt the power of God to save a soul. If you are saved, you know. Now, if you're really young, you're like, I wasn't that bad. Well, live a little longer, you would have been that bad. But some of us who came to faith in Christ not as a little child, you knew how bad you were. Never doubt the power of God to save a soul. Here's what he did. He cut the people of Jerusalem to the heart, and all the people that were around from all those places, everybody from everywhere, transforms Peter into this fearless preacher. The question you have to ask yourself is, have I come before the holy God as a sinner seeking mercy for Christ's sake? Have I come before the holy God, the one true God, as a sinner seeking mercy for the sake of Christ? There's nothing here about unity and diversity, just souls saved. Read an article recently, and it was about delighting in God through diversity, and it actually sounded pretty good at first, and something just wasn't ringing true, and it was from a group that I usually really like their articles, and I felt kind of wary, and I was like, wait, I know what it is. It's man-centered. It's upside down. It's like I heard a sermon recently like that where it said heaven is diverse, and we don't lose our ethnic cultural distinctives because God saves people from all nations, tribes, peoples, and tongues. That's true. I'm going to be an Italian in heaven. But also Irish, English, Scottish, and Welsh. That's right. Italy's not in the World Cup, okay? We're not winning, but I want USA to win and beat the Welsh. But I don't think it's the point. But the point that's getting made is that God saves people from every nation, tribe, language, and people. In tongues. But he doesn't primarily highlight the unity in diversity. It's just saying God saves all kinds of people and he shows no partiality. And Peter had to learn that lesson. And so in Acts 10, Peter says, I now understand that God shows no partiality, and in every nation, everyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. He makes us one in the church. And the focus is not on what we look like or where we came from or how we talk or the color of our skin. God is not saying heaven is diverse, so focus on that. What he's saying is, I save without partiality, and you should be focused on me. A God-centered vision of life will be what you say, I will learn from anybody, and I will try to reach everybody. And if we are a Christ-centered community, as we say on the wall and we say in our tongues, then we will not worry as a church if we represent every ethnicity and are diverse enough. We will just reach everyone with the gospel. Don't think about the color of someone's skin. Think about the condition of their soul. A love for Christ should make us more loving towards all. And if you care, you'll take every person into consideration. Every person. You know, if you start counting, you start critiquing. But if you care, you take every person into consideration. The nature of the church, we are the community of the called out ones committed to Christ's kingdom. And then we see the function. It just flows right from the nature. The function of the church, it exists for Christ. It is his church. We are committed to Christ's kingdom, not our own. Christ's kingdom. The church was committed to Christ. Look at verse 42, the most famous verse in this passage. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. It was a continual devotion. Devoted followers, they were committed, they were continually devoted. That word devoted means you're a personal attendant. You stand at the ready for the Lord to give the word, and you hear the word. They were hearing the word. We do the same thing. We devote ourselves to the apostles' teaching. Ephesians 2:20 says that the church was built on the foundation of the apostles and the prophets. We teach the same word that they preached. We preach the same word. True repentance for sin and crying out to God for mercy, as what happened in verses 37 and 38, that's the only proper response to the preaching of the word of God. And they prayed. They're praying and they're fellowshipping. That word fellowship is not, hey, I had a good time with some friends and we talked about just life in general. This is a close association involving mutual involvement and relationships centered on Christ. And it's great to catch up on how things went this week, and you should. But it's focused on Christ ultimately. Fellowship is where you share of yourself and you share of yourselves to help each other grow in Christ. They focused on communion. Is it the breaking of the bread? The partaking of the breaking of the bread at the Lord's table, remembering Jesus' sacrifice in our place as our substitute, shedding his blood. They remembered. They did this. The word, prayer, fellowship, communion. They were together doing this. They devoted themselves to this. They continued to do this. In 1 John, speaking of a group of people that used to be a part of the believers, and then turns out they weren't believers. It says they went out from us. They were not of us. If they had been of us, they would have continued with us. But they went out that they might be manifest that they were not all of us. That doesn't mean someone that leaves a church and goes to another church. That's not what this is talking about. It's talking about someone who left the faith because they didn't have the faith. He said to the Colossians, if you continue in the faith, grounded and settled, and don't be moved from the hope of the gospel. Continue on in Christ, word, prayer, fellowship, the Lord's table. This is what they were doing. This is what they were doing when Jesus first was ascended. In chapter 1, back in Acts chapter 1, what you'll notice is that the apostles and the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and his brothers, here's what they were doing in Acts 1:14. All these, with one accord, were devoting themselves to prayer. They were praying. They were depending on God. Paul told the Corinthians, he goes, you know, I'm afraid for you. I'm afraid that as Satan deceived Eve by his craftiness, your minds would be led astray from the simplicity and purity of devotion to Christ. The very real temptation. And so stick to the word of God. Stick to prayer. Stick to fellowship. Stick to the Lord's table and remembering Christ. And I think what needs to happen, and I find it happens in my heart like all the time, is that we need to be defrosted. When I was a kid, my mom and dad would buy like half a cow and then spend a whole evening cutting steaks and grinding ground beef, grinding ground sirloin. And then when I was a kid, I would come home from school and there'd be like a stack of steaks sitting there defrosting. It was before the microwave era. But now we just put it in the microwave and defrost. But how many times is your heart frozen when you come into the assembly of the believers? You're racked with guilt. You're wrecked in life. You're in pain in some way. Maybe you're against somebody in some way. Maybe you're kind of bracing yourself to see a certain person because you're not getting along with them. Our hearts need to be defrosted, and they're defrosted by the Word of God and prayer and fellowship and the Lord's table, remembering Jesus. We're a living organism growing together with the body of Christ, with the bride of Christ, which is what God is building. You know, some people say, you know, I can do this at home. I can read my Bible at home. I can read a good book at home. And by the way, if you're watching on live stream and you can't get to church, we are not talking about you. You would be here if you could. We know that. But there are some people that say, I can do the Christian life on my own. I don't need the church. Well, Puritan Richard Baxter had a good answer. What foolish pretense against the plain command of God and our own necessary duty. When God has appointed you your duty, will he allow you to forsake it upon your own reason as if you were wiser than him? A lot of people think they're smarter than God. The light bulb came on for me recently about grass. Green grass growing. Not the fake turf, green grass growing. And I realized something. When it's green, it's because of sunlight and water. And when it's brown, those two things have been missing. And what happens is the sunlight and water for a Christian is the word and prayer and fellowship and remembering Jesus and remembering the gospel and being together with fellow believers and processing life together. And you just do the fundamentals, you do the basics, like dribbling, passing, and shooting in basketball. You practice the fundamentals, you practice the basics. You do the simple, ordinary things over and over again. And what happens is you see the aggregate results. You do the basics and see what happens. It's like grass springing up over a few days. The other day I was with one of my kids, we were hiking in the hills, and literally we're looking around, we're like, there was no grass and green all around here 2 days ago. Just up, because it had been raining. By the way, why did the brand new church do what they did in verse 42? You ever thought about that? Why'd they do it? Like, we know what they did. Oh, yeah, we know what they did, but why did they do it? Let me tell you what the answer isn't. Well, that's what Jews did. Not the answer. Here's the answer. Because that's what Jesus taught them to do. They couldn't go, hey, let's see what they're doing out in Ephesus and see how we do church. We need a little outreach program. Let's see what they're doing in, you know, Philippi. They were the only church. And they started doing this, and we're still doing this. Why? It's because what Jesus taught. Jesus taught them of the Word of God. He said, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. He's talking about the written Word of God. And the Son prays to the Father and says, your word is truth, John 17, 17. Sanctify them in the truth. The Jews were saying, you got Jesus all wrong. You got the Old Testament all wrong. And Jesus says, oh no, it all points to me. You search the scriptures and you think in them you have eternal life. They're pointing to me. Go into the word. Jesus taught them of the word and how much they needed it. Jesus taught them how to pray. Lord, teach us how to pray. Here's how you pray. Jesus taught them how to fellowship. You'll love one another. That's how all people will know that you're my disciples, if you have love one for another. It's pretty simple, folks. Not brain surgery. Jesus taught them the breaking of the bread. To remember him consistently with the gathered body. The church would say, yeah, we're believers and we're following Jesus. That this new, brand new church had no plan but the plan that Jesus gave them. Just did what They did what Jesus taught them. They were committed to Christ. And what's the upshot of that? What's the outflow of that? Awe. Look at verse 43. The church was awestruck. When was the last time you were awestruck? Like literally in awestruck wonder of something. Awe came upon every soul. Every soul had awe. And many wonders and signs were being done through the apostles. And awe, from a Greek word phobos, it literally means, it's where we got a word phobia. They were fearful. That means to be put to flight. It's panic flight. It's respect. It's reverence. Like you have for fire. You've been putting on the fireplace recently at home, and here's what I do. I go up and I open up the door of the fireplace, and I get my UCLA fire starter. And then I walk over to the side and turn the gas thing, then walk back over, and I'm like clicking. It's not working. Poof! You know, it's like, well, I needed to, to trim that hair right there. I have a respect for fire. You fear fire. Bible tells me our God is a consuming fire. Hebrews 12. And what they're in awe of is like, God did this. Wow. God made us the community of the called out ones that are committed to Christ's kingdom. We didn't want that before. Like 2 days ago, we were going, those guys are crazy. They were in awe because of what God did. When was the last time you were in awe of the word of God? We're singing the praises of God. We're singing the word of God. We're praying the word of God. We're hearing the preaching of the word of God. When was the last time God gave you some awe for him such that you would say, wow, I was saved by grace. I was on my way to hell. And Jesus saved my soul. I believed and I'm forgiven. When was the last time you were in awe of God? You saw God work in the heart of someone, your heart or someone else's heart, and you're like, only God could do that. God is awesome. And it says signs and wonders were being done by the apostles. Acts 4, it says signs and wonders, great power. There were great power gave the apostles witness of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, and great grace was on them all. Hebrews 2 says it was attested by signs and wonders. This was the very first church. It needed the signs and wonders to give credence to the gospel message. And then you get on along to, Acts chapter 5, and you've got the Ananias and Sapphira debacle. Brand new church. And Ananias and Sapphira, that situation was a sign and wonder. Left people shaking in their boots. The kids were crying. The people were running. But they were giving credence to the gospel at the birth of the church. I mean, tons of Christians had done way worse than they did. One of our elders came to Grace Church on the first Sunday, like some 30 years ago, when it was church discipline was getting done. He's like, I ain't going to that church. They'll kick you out if you sin too much. People are saying, you know what they're saying then? I'm not going to that church. You might die if you lie. It's like seeing the most amazing, awe-inspiring forest fire that you know you need to stay away from because it's gonna consume you. We're awestruck at the wondrous glory of God in the gospel. And some of us, we just want to be told we're right. You know, isn't it interesting? Some people want to be told what is right. Like, here's what the word says. Some want to say, just tell me that I'm right, because I know I am. We're accustomed to self-will. We're accustomed to feeling right. But I think in the presence of a holy God, that we can only fall on our faces and say, oh, no, I'm wrong. I'm wrong. And worship him and confess your sins and confess his greatness. And say, wow, I'm awestruck because of what God has done in my life. John Owen put it this way, there's an intimate union between Christ and his church. And it makes it just and right in the sight of God that what Christ did and suffered should be reckoned and imputed to us as if we had done and suffered the same things ourselves. This union took place by his choice. And because of it, believers see him as glorious indeed. He said, one view of Christ's glory by faith will scatter all the fears, answer all the objections, and disperse all the depressions of poor, tempted, doubting souls. It's an anchor which they may cast within the veil to hold them firm and steadfast in all trials, storms, and temptations, both in life and in death. You can find yourself at awe of God in the midst of the storm. Awe in your soul over the greatness of God, that the alarm goes off in your head and says, whoa, this is not a momentary happiness because my team won. I'm not glad because I got what I wanted. Oh, no, I saw Almighty God at work. He called me out of darkness into his marvelous light, into a family I didn't choose, to a destiny I didn't choose. And every day I wake up and I choose to live in that reality. And my hope of heaven drives me to want to live to please God. You know how it goes. Some people play church as long as it feels good. Get what they want, remain relatively happy. But if it gets uncomfortable or they're asked to do too much, they're going to leave or cause division. Well, that person misunderstood the nature and function of the church. We are the community of the called out ones committed to Christ's kingdom. And if you're not saved, you haven't been called out by Christ. You're not part of the church. You might be a weed in the midst of wheat. You might be a wolf among sheep. You might belong to a church, but not be part of the true church. If you're not committed to Christ's kingdom, you're messing up the church. You're trying to build your own kingdom. You're trying to build the kingdom of some man with clay feet. Some of you are like, oh, Mike's all upset today. His team lost yesterday. I just want us to be a healthy church. I don't know what's going on. All I know is this is hitting me. I always pray, Lord, may the word hit the hearts of the people right where it needs to hit. Lord, land the blows like a boxer. The church was committed to Christ, awestruck, and guess what? It all happened being together. Look at verse 44. All who believed were together. They had all things in common. They were together. They were unified in purpose. But guess what? Let's talk about this right up front. There is a roadblock in the way of togetherness in the church. Unfair judgment. That's the roadblock. Unfair judgment. If you prejudge others, you will relate to them based on your judgment, not God's assessment. Think about anybody that you were like, man, I'm going to Grace today and I'm going to try to stay away from this person that I have an issue with. Or I know that person's only going to say this or that. Some people, by the way, are division magnets. You know, I bought a magnet once. It's a fishing magnet. And you can like put this thing on a rope down into the water and, you know, find guns in lakes. And it's really strong. I haven't used it yet. Some people are division magnets. They just pick up the division. It's like mosquito magnets. I'm a mosquito magnet. A study was once shown that mosquito magnets are real due to their smell. I guess I smell great. I don't know. Got that oily skin. Researchers found that people that are most attractive to mosquitoes produce a lot of certain chemicals on their skin, and it's tied to their smell, and the bloodsuckers are very loyal to their favorite, people they like to get. They did an experiment, and they pitted people's scents against each other, and it says they swarmed to the most attractive subjects. Biggest mosquito magnet is 100 times more attractive to mosquitoes. And they, by the way, mosquitoes are very resilient. They have ways to find you. They're going to find you and bite you. That's the same thing in the church. Gossips and backbiters and divisive people find their targets very easily. And by the way, if you go, people just tell me stuff. Oh, no. They know you'll accept it. You tell them, oh, that's gossip. Oh, I'm not going to accept that. They're not coming back to you. That church mosquito will not land on you anymore. You won't hear the little hum in your ear, a whisper in your ear. Don't be a church mosquito. Together, by the way, doesn't mean in the same room but not talking. Ooh. Husbands and wives, listen up. Together implies belonging, engagement, forbearance, patience, sharing, caring, interaction, empathizing, understanding, dealing with tough stuff to please other people, not ourselves. This is what the scriptures tell us. Let each one of us please his neighbor for his good and edification and not just please ourselves. The church is not a grocery store or a mini mart. And you guys are all like, just because UCLA lost yesterday has nothing to do with that. Think about it, though. The church is not a grocery store or mini mart. You can just come get what you want. I'm preaching to the choir. You already know this. You don't just pop in and get what you want. No, it's the community of the called out ones committed to Christ's kingdom. And such you are. You know, recently I had this a little fire pit in my backyard and the edge was a little cracked. I got some really strong Gorilla Glue. It is still holding firm. That tight bond, unbreakable connection. This is what we have because of the blood of Christ. An unbreakable connection because Jesus died for our sins. And the blood of Christ dissolves and destroys divisive things. You mend the fracture. Sometimes you got to put a cast on. But the church develops deep bonds such that love is allowed to season. You got to think loving the church versus doing church. Engaged in life together. Bonhoeffer put it this way: Christianity means community through Jesus Christ and in Jesus Christ. No Christian community is more or less than this. Church was committed to Christ. They were awestruck and they were together. And then in verse 45, we see that they were generous. Look at verse 45. They were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing the proceeds to all as any had need. Anybody want my watch, by the way? Can you take that? I got one taker here. Take my watch. I'm serious. I was willing to do it. You can do whatever you want with that. You can keep it. You can give it back. You can give it to someone else. That's my favorite watch, by the way. But you know what? First hour, nobody took it. I like my jacket. I got a buddy here, and we'll say, hey, I like your shirt. And he's like, okay, I'll give it to you. They were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing the proceeds to all as any had need. They were sharing. They were selling real estate. They were supporting, they were giving the proceeds of the property, except Ananias and Sapphira, of course. They were meeting needs. Paul told the Corinthians, look, if you sow sparingly, you'll reap sparingly. If you sow bountifully, you'll reap bountifully. Everyone, according to how you purpose in your heart, God loves a cheerful giver. Don't do it grudgingly. God is able to make all grace abound to you. Having sufficiency in all things, you will abound to every good work. It was relief for the church, Acts 11. There was an issue. And the disciples, according to their ability, determined to send relief to the brethren in Judea because there was an issue going on. They needed help. Look at it, Acts 11. What was the issue? What was going on? There was a famine. There was a famine. And so the disciples, verse 29, determined that everyone, according to his ability, would send relief to the brothers living in Judea. And they did so. They sent it. They parted with their stuff. Titus says, let our people learn how to engage in good deeds to meet pressing needs. That is so different from the consumer-driven way of doing church. By the way, if you're treating the church like a grocery store where you go get what you want and then pay for it, you have a warped view of the church. If, on the other hand, you liken it more to picking up a prescription that a doctor who knows more than you and knows what you actually need, wrote up for you, you're a bit more in the ballpark, but you're still off the point. There was a pastor that was approached by a man who wanted to join the church, and the man says, by the way, I'm going to join your church, but I will not ever be available. I'm too busy. I won't be available to help with anything. Don't call on me to serve. Pastor says, oh, you're at the wrong church. You got to go to this one church, three blocks down, and then turn right. The guy goes three blocks down, turns right. There's an old, abandoned church building that's all boarded up. The church is the community of the called out ones under the headship of the sovereign Lord of the universe, operating in local communities that are interdependent and fully dependent on the Lord of the universe. They're actively serving the extraordinary God in ordinary ways, and God's wisdom gives eternal results. Human wisdom will give you human results. But God, if you're a believer, God saved you to be a part of his bride, part of his body, a part of what he is building, comprised of many parts. To the local assemblies where you commit to one another. You commit to a real local church under a plurality of male elders, preaching the word, praying, administering the ordinances, practicing church discipline, caring for your soul as shepherds, where you do your part. You dive in, you show up on time. I know recently we've been saying, hey, you need to get here on time. First hour, someone's walking in. By the way, if I'm over there, right before you're coming in, I'm not going click, 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 oh, you're late, you're on time, da, 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 da. I don't even know what time it is. Someone goes, I'm on time. I'm like, I love you. I'm so glad you're here. If you came in late, I don't know which one you were. We're not like, ooh, all worried, but you do want to be here together with us. We can rejoice together in the goodness of God. I think it's good to be on time. I think it's good to serve. I think it's good to sincerely share your life with other people. If you're promoting yourself, on the other hand, it doesn't matter how good it sounds or how many people like what you say, you're a fraud, you're a fake, you're falsifying evidence. If you're living your life for the attention of others, you're going to end up begging for that attention in very subtle, startling, self-glorifying ways. You might even say, it's for Jesus. But we have eyes and ears. If Christ is your everything, you don't need to try everything to be noticed. You just find someone to bless. You just find something to invest in. Be others mindful and self-forgetful and no thought of yourself. That you would even today say, I'm going to go do something that will bless someone else today. That, wow, Jesus saved me for himself and he put me in his church and there's work for me to do. And oftentimes there's no spotlight attached to it. In fact, there's hardly ever a spotlight attached to it, but there's someone to bless, someone to love, and even if it's on Instagram, it is real. Even if it isn't on Instagram, it's real. We have everything we need right now as a church to do everything God calls us to do. Everything. We don't lack any good gift. The church, the first church, was committed to Christ. It was awestruck. It was together. It was generous, and it was grateful. Grateful. Verse 46. We're in Thanksgiving week. This is perfect. Day by day, attending the temple together and breaking bread in their homes, they received their food with glad and generous hearts. They were glad of what God was doing. They were humble about it. And day by day, they attended the temple. It was the focal point of the social interaction. The religious center. It was big enough. It was colonnades there. It literally, when it says they were going to the temple, it refers to the courts surrounding the temple. And it's where the people met. And they met under God. Regardless if they had a building or not, then they were breaking bread. Verse 46, breaking bread is eating meals in homes. Verse 42, breaking the bread is the communion. And it says that they were doing this things that they were doing gladly. That's talking about the joy that's brought about by God's saving acts. They did it with glad and humble hearts. It says the same thing in Acts 5:42, but it tacks on something. It says, every day in the temple and from house to house, they kept teaching and preaching Christ. Church was committed to Christ and awestruck and together and generous and grateful. And in verse 47, it praised God. You notice this? The church praised God. This is what the church does. We praise God. Praising God and having favor with all the people. The church praised God and the church grew and the Lord added to their number day by day those who were being saved. But I just want to put a hard stop on having favor. Wait a minute. We don't live in the 80s anymore where in the Reagan years it was just cool to be a Christian, cool to be an evangelical. People kind of hate the church now. Kind of how's it biblically supposed to be, I guess. How do you explain the church having favor with all, yet no one wanting to be a part of the church? We're not going there. You might die if you lie. People didn't want to be a part of them, and yet droves of people are getting added to the church. How do we explain this? Think about it. Everything's going smoothly in this first church until Ananias and Sapphira shows up. They were probably there on the day of Pentecost, but they were hatching plans behind the scenes. And I'll say it again, plenty of professed believers have done way worse than they did. Caused a greater ruckus than Ananias and Sapphira, but this was the very first church, and it needed to be kept pure. So, for example, you did something, God knows you did it, and you might think you got away with something, but he knows full well what's on your heart. Nothing escapes him. That's why I constantly have to be saying, Lord, cleanse my heart, purify my heart, guard my heart, convict my heart of my sin and selfishness. Set me back on the path of pleasing you and glorifying you above all. We'll live for the good of your kingdom. But it says here, go to Acts 5. You've got to see what happened. In Acts 5, here are these people, the community of the called out ones committed to Christ's kingdom, who contributed nothing to their salvation, as Jonathan Edwards said, except the sin that made it necessary. And what happens is Ananias and Sapphira happens, and then in chapter 5, verse 13, none of the rest dared join them. Nobody's wanting to join the church. Understandably so. There's great fear. They're not joining. But wait. Look what it says. But the people held them in high esteem. What does that mean? They respected the believers and their life that they were able to observe as they cared for one another and praised God. And what does it tell us in verse 14? More than ever, believers were added to the Lord, multitudes of both men and women. How do we explain this? No one dared associate with them. There was great fear in joining them, and God added more and more that were being saved. And then Acts chapter 6 happens. Complaint. Complainers in the church, you know, if you're a complainer, and you were, this is the forerunner to you, I guess. You know, they were complaining that somebody wasn't getting this and that, and the apostles figured it out. But even then, it says in verse 7, Acts 6, 7, the word of God continued to increase and the number of disciples multiplied greatly in Jerusalem. It's like God keeps growing his church in spite of our sinfulness. I mean, what's your biggest challenge in being part of the church? What's your biggest blessing? Share that with somebody. But what is going on? God is adding to his church in spite of us. Not because if more and more people come to Grace Church, you're like, oh, we must be a cool church. No, Jesus saves people and sanctifies people. When the Gentiles heard this, Acts 13, they were glad, they glorified the word of the Lord. As many as were ordained to eternal life believed. A lot of times, you know what Christians do? They ruin the gospel witness because they scream at the top of their lungs or relationally, deal with it, fellow believers. I'm going to do what I want to do. Often in gray areas, often in sin areas. And what we find in the Bible, you see it in 1 Corinthians 8, 9, and 10. You find it in Romans 14. It is better to offend the unbeliever before you cause a fellow believer to stumble and be harmed. So many believers are like, hey, my fellow believers, they'll even tell unbelievers that the church isn't good. What are you thinking? Like, if you're living in Christ-centered community, you take care of one another. Now, the Bible tells us evangelism is fruitful when an unbeliever condemns you for caring for a fellow Christian. Check it out later. 1 Corinthians 10, 28 to 33. My words are true because the Bible is true. And what happens is if someone isn't loving the church, their evangelism is tainted. They're giving people food poisoning. Like, how much poison is good in the baby food? Now, here's the deal. This was the very first church. They just did what Jesus said. They had their problems because they had sinful people in it, like every church does. But the church is the community of the called out ones committed to Christ's kingdom. It's from Christ. It's adopted into his family for Christ. It is his. That's the nature and the function of church. I think it was Joel Beakey who said, the church after Pentecost was marked by faithfulness and fellowship and fear and fervency. You trace it out. Trace it out in verses 41 to 47. Say, hey, is this characterizing me? Or does this characterize us? How can this increase at Grace Church? It's like when you lose. When you lose, if you go, wow, I'm kind of messed up here. When you lose, if you're for real, you have a greater resolve to learn and grow, to improve. And here's the great thing. You were added into the church by the Lord, therefore you're secure. We're together in Christ, but most importantly, we're indwelt and kept by the Lord of his church. In 1555, Nicholas Ridley was burned at the stake because of his faith in Christ. Night before his execution, his brother came to him and offered to remain with him in the prison chamber, to be of assistance, to be of comfort, and Ridley said no. He said, no, I'm going to bed, and I'm going to sleep as quietly as I ever did in my whole life, because I know the peace of God, and I can rest in the strength of the everlasting arms of Jesus to meet my need. And so can we. Bottom line, though, is in a world gone wrong, we need each other. And the only thing that makes sense is living to the glory of God, waking up tomorrow morning and saying, I'm going to live another day to serve Jesus however I can with the strength that he provides, and I'm going to start the week with his people. I'm going to continue through the week with his people. And that you will know, as you love the church, is the best witness to a watching and waiting world, and then take the gospel everywhere you go. Rubbish redeemed. We are the community of the called out ones committed to Christ's kingdom. And Lord, we thank you and praise you, love you because you first loved us, that you would call us into your church. Even now, Lord, there might be some among us or some listening that are not a part of your church. Lord, may they believe the gospel of your grace in Christ. May they believe that Jesus died in their place on the cross, taking the punishment their sins deserve. May they believe that Jesus died and was buried and rose on the third day. And may they believe that Jesus is coming again. And for all your people, Lord, may you strengthen us. May you strengthen us as we live in community, the community of the called out ones, that we would live committed to your kingdom and your glory. We pray in your name. Amen.
Amen. Please stand if you're able as we close singing together.
Oh, Christ, be the center of our life. Be the place we fix our eyes. Be the center. The center of the universe, everything was made in you. Jesus, breath of every living thing, everyone was made for you. You hold everything together. Fix our eyes, be the center of our lives.
Real quick before we go, a couple announcements. We've got a devotional thing we put together for coming up to Thanksgiving, reading 2 Corinthians and some Psalms. We've got our Christmas series and other Christmas things that are happening. And on December 18th, we're going to have another baptism. I know we just had a baptism a couple weeks ago. We've got like 7 or 8 people that are going to get baptized on December 18th at 12:30 after church with a little lunch afterwards. So make sure you mark that on your calendar. And we're going to close with Hebrews 12, 1 and 2. Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and the sin which clings so closely, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. Lord, we praise you and thank you for this time we could gather to sing, to pray, hear your word, and we pray that you would send us now by your grace and for your glory to serve your purposes. We pray in Jesus' name, amen.
Sovereign in the mountain.